Ding-a-ling, ding-a-ling goes the telephone. Ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a goes my heart. Ding-a-ling, ding-a-ling goes the telephone. And I know that the fireworks will start. Could be the butcher or the baker or the man with some fish on his tray. Could be the grocer or the candlestick maker or the boy across the way to say...
Welcome to Cybersecurity and Mobile Devices. Now, I bet most of you are thinking about your cell phones. But surprise, I'm going to be talking about all of your devices that travel with you and attach to wireless networks. Things like mobile phones, tablets, and even smart watches, just to name a few. I'm Robin Saunders, and I'm a cybersecurity educator. With my three websites and free interactive ebook, I provide educational resources that help you and your family stay safe while you're in cyberspace. The landscape of cybersecurity crime is constantly changing and growing as crafty hackers seek out new ways to steal your money. And over the past few years, there's been a slew of headlines that have been reporting massive data hacks on major platforms with companies such as Uber, Google, Marriott, Target, and others. These hackers have stolen millions of consumers' personal information, including names, social security numbers, addresses, and credit card numbers. But I'm sure that some of you already know this. Now, I'm also sure that some of you probably remember a time when we didn't even have cell phones.
Before cell phones, there were car phones.
Good morning, Ms. Ricardo. How did the market open?
In fact, the original car phone weighed about 80 pounds. In 1947, an engineer at Bell Labs envisioned a futuristic phone network for their car phones. A call would bounce uninterrupted between cells of coverage. At the time, the technology and the infrastructure for this did not exist, but it soon would. The car phones quickly became popular despite their limitations. Only a limited number of people could use the service at a time, which meant 5 to 10 year waiting lists began to form, and existing customers could sometimes wait up to 30 minutes to place a call. But then, in 1973, Motorola engineer Martin Cooper showed what the future would look like, the Dynatac 8000X. Based on Bell's cell network concept, it was the world's first handheld cell phone. 10 years and a $100 million investment later, Motorola finally released the phone to the public.
I'd like to order a large pizza with mushrooms, anchovies, and the hottest peppers you can find.
The decade-long delay was caused by the need to build the cellular infrastructure the phone required to operate. The phone took 10 hours to charge, lasted 35 minutes, and cost $3,995, which would be about $10,000 today.
I remember those days, and I'm so glad that things have evolved to the smartphones that we have today. When it comes to cybercrime, your mobile phone is a big target. Your phone's connected to the internet, because most phones are, and you face the same cybersecurity threats as desktop computer users. Now, many of the cyber threats that attack our mobile devices are simply a mobile version of a threat that faces desktop computer users.
Morning. Well, as the number of mobile devices explodes, so does the number of attacks on our cell phones. Sometimes you know your phone has been hacked, but often you don't. We sat down with some of the world's best hackers who showed us just how easy it is for them to get access to everything on your phone.
Is everything hackable?
Yes.
Everything?
Yes.
If somebody tells you, you can't do it.
I don't believe it.
John Herring offered to prove it. So he gathered a group of ace hackers at our Las Vegas hotel. Each of them a specialist in cracking mobile devices and figuring out how to protect them.
Would you put your money in a bank that didn't test the locks on their safes? You know, we need to try and break it to make sure that the bad guys can't.
How easy is it to break the phone right now?
Very easy.
As you've seen, pretty trivial.
So do I need to connect to it?
Yeah.
Okay.
It started when we logged on to the hotel Wi-Fi. At least, it looked like the hotel Wi-Fi. Herring had created a ghost version. It's called spoofing.
I mean, this looks legitimate.
It looks very legitimate. So are you connected?
I am.
And I have your email.
You have access to my email right
now?
Yeah,
it's coming through right now. I now have a ride-sharing application up here. All the information that's being transmitted, including your account ID, your mobile phone, which I just got the mobile number, then more importantly, I have all the credit cards associated with that account.
Now, this hack that you just saw only took a matter of minutes, and I was fooled by that fake Wi-Fi, but in other demonstrations that we're going to show you on Sunday, the hackers were able to exploit a hole in the global cellular network and get into our phones, turn on our cameras, listen to us. All they needed for that was a phone number. With just the phone number, they could hack into my phone.
It's incredible. So what do you think the greatest weakness is in mobile security?
I mean, we're the greatest weakness because, like what I just did, where it said, you know, the hotel name and the Wi-Fi, I believed that that was it. I connected, and they really easily got control of my phone. But there's this bigger problem of this hole in the global cellular network that it doesn't matter what you do, what decisions you make, whether you turn location services on or off, they can still get into your cell phone.
Now, that's pretty scary stuff. But there are some things that you can do to limit the amount of cyber threats that your phone is susceptible to. Now, these days, just about everyone has some type of mobile device. Some of you have a smartphone, some others have tablets, and many of us have smartwatches, just to name a few. Because remember, a lot of anything that connects to the internet is susceptible to these sort of challenges. You pretty much can't get along in society without a smartphone to help you check things like your Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Pinterest, or YouTube account. I bet some of you also message your friends, and I'm among these people, definitely use mapping applications to get directions. Also, many of us check our bank accounts and our credit card statements, and oh yes, even some of us make actual phone calls using our smartphones. What you may not know about your mobile device and all of your awesome applications is that this represents the fastest growing attack service for cyber criminals. Now, most of us take these devices wherever we go, and every day our mobile devices are exposed to more networks and other devices than any other piece of equipment we know. Think about how many different networks your cell phone interfaces with in a day. Not even to mention the fact that by taking these devices wherever we go, it's much more likely that they're going to be lost or stolen. And mobile phones contain a lot of personal information about you. Many of the applications on your phone provide access to your bank accounts or other accounts that contain sensitive information. And some of these applications also store credit card information that can allow criminals to buy whatever they want and to ship it wherever they want to ship it to. Yikes. Well, in addition, your phone probably contains direct access to your email, your text messages, your social media accounts, and can be used to steal your identity and also trick your friends into providing their sensitive information as well. Just think about what can happen if an attacker actually physically gets a hold of your mobile phone. It's pretty scary how much information you actually keep in there. But what you didn't know is that there are a growing number of what we call exploits that take advantage of your phone's Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, and cellular connections to gain virtual access to your phone. Let's see how that works.
We've been warned repeatedly that using free public Wi-Fi can put our personal information at risk. But facing a choice of using up our data or connecting with free Wi-Fi, most of us take the gamble.
So what is the risk? WBZ's Christina Hager got a lesson from a real-life hacker.
The risk for the public networks is because they're out there, they're open, unencrypted. An attacker can join it just as easily as you can.
And that's exactly what we did with the help of hacking expert Steve Walker.
I can see all the different networks out there, all the different clients, and which one do I want to look like?
Wicked free Wi-Fi is available here on the Boston Common, and Steve created his own imposter version with a laptop and small device anyone can buy online.
And that didn't take too long.
No, it didn't take long at all.
Anyone closer to his signal than the one the city is blasting out will only see the fake wicked free Wi-Fi option. And if your device connected to the real system in the past, it could even automatically join this rogue Wi-Fi network.
So you just called it the same thing?
Yeah.
Or is there any slight difference?
Nope.
While the name is exactly the same, the login page is different.
And that's my login page that I gave you.
For Steve's fake Wi-Fi, he created these two phishing links to Facebook and Gmail.
I could sign in here, and now you know my Facebook password.
That's right. Password was Hager.
Yeah, C. Hager. That's my name.
Steve is seeing every letter as I type it.
Could you be a fake business and take someone's credit card information?
Yep.
And even if you don't fall for the links, once you're connected to the imposter Wi-Fi, he knows your every online move.
You're going to Google.
Anything I'm reading, you can see what I'm interested in.
Yep.
This vulnerability can be exposed through any free and open Wi-Fi at coffee shops, stores, airports, hotels, anywhere.
There's always a risk when you join any type of public Wi-Fi.
If you do join, cyber defense expert Peter Tran recommends turning off any file sharing apps. And for iPhone users, this means AirDrop.
And if you're going to be on public Wi-Fi, make sure you're not working with sensitive data or things that you normally would not want to just share with everybody.
And before typing in credit card numbers or passwords, look at the address bar and make sure you see this lock, meaning the website is secure. On Steve's fake Google page, the address bar didn't even have that lock. And instead of google.com, you only see a series of numbers. That's a big red flag. All of this adds up to the reason for this advice.
If you don't have to get on public Wi-Fi, don't do it.
Christina Hager, WBZ News.
Remember, as I said before, mobile devices can be infected with the same malware as your desktop computer, so you need to be careful. So, what can you do to make your mobile devices more secure? The first is a strong password, and it's a must. You need to set a strong password on your phone to make it difficult for the attackers to gain access to the sensitive information if they get their hands on the device. Now, by default, many phones do not even require a password. And even if you enable a password and PIN protection, the default length might be too short. On an iPhone, you can look into your phone settings, enable the PIN or password protection, and make sure that the password that you provide is long and complex so that it's not easy to guess. So even if you lose the phone, you'll be very, very glad that you had a complex password. On an Android phone, it's a little bit more complicated, but because there are so many different manufacturers, you need to check with the manufacturer's instruction on how to do this. And you remember that you can always check out the webinar Simply Passwords if you need advice on how to create the perfect password. Next, if your mobile device allows you to log in with a fingerprint, you can add a substantial security to your device. Your fingerprints are much more complex than any password that you can remember, and they're also very, very difficult to spoof. If you use fingerprint recognition, it's also going to be much more convenient for you to log into your device because it's literally the touch of a button. Now also be aware that most devices will still require a backup password just in case something happens to the scanner or your finger. And the good news is you won't have to use these passwords that often, so you can make it very long and complex and save it in a nice, safe place until you need it. Next, you need to turn off your Wi-Fi and Bluetooth broadcasting when you don't need to use them. And fortunately, most mobile devices make it easy to disable these wireless services and stop the unnecessary broadcasting. So when you don't need them, turn them off. The same is true of your cellular connection. Your phone is most secure when it's in airplane mode. So if you don't need to be reachable for a stretch of time, like when you're at a movie or on an airplane, just put the phone into airplane mode. Next, remember location, location, location. Have you ever gone into a retail store and received notifications on your phone that contain coupons or links to the current deals? Retailers constantly use location data to create targeted advertising campaigns, and this may be with or without your consent. Location-based services such as GPS are present on most cell phones. Other devices such as tablets and laptops and desktop computers may also have location-based services, so you need to check that. They provide a way for applications to calculate where the device is. Some location services use GPS, and others just use your Wi-Fi point for mapping. So let's look at this.
Well, did you know your iPhone is recording every place you visit?
I think we do now.
Yeah, now we do, yeah.
The University of New Haven professor who first uncovered the phone's tracking feature now says there is a way to turn it off, but should you? News 8's Kent Pierce, live in News 8 Control, with the debate to track or not to track. Kent.
Jocelyn and Keith, that is the question, or at least it is now that Apple has given us a choice. You may think it's an easy choice because a lot of people are creeped out by the fact that their phone records not only where they are, but where they've been and how long they were there, too. The head of the University of New Haven Cyber Forensics Research and Education Group. That's a mouthful, but he was the first one to discover that our iPhones were actually tracking us. That was 5 years ago. There was no off switch for it then, but there is now. So should you turn it off? Well, if you're already Instagramming every place you go, checking in on Facebook, and tweeting what you're doing every moment, then who cares? We value our privacy less and less these days, it seems. And there are useful apps out there that do require a location. Here's what our professor does.
I use Uber sometimes, right? I only turn on my location, so that I can use Uber so that the cab can come and pick me up. But then after that's done, I turn it off.
Just yesterday, we saw another use for phone tracking. A couple got carjacked in Hamden, and the woman's iPhone was still in the car. Police were able to track the phone and find the car. The car ended up getting totaled in a high-speed police chase, yes, but the point is they found the car. And police also find the location tracking very useful when they're trying to find a bad guy or convict a bad guy, because you get his phone and you know exactly where he was at the time the crime happened. Criminal or not, if you want to turn it off, go to location services, then system services, and then select frequent locations to see for yourself what exactly your phone is recording. Then you can decide for yourself if you want it to continue. Live in News 8 Control, I'm Kent Pierce. Back to you.
There are also a few other reasons to turn location-based services off if you're not using them. And the first is that the unused service will actually drain your battery and use up cellular data. So know that. The other reason is that some apps on the device may be using location-based services to spy on you. This data can be sold and used for all sorts of purposes, including targeted marketing and advertising campaigns. You have no control over who has access to this data. And if retailers get access to your data, think about who else can access it. And just when you thought that there couldn't possibly be anything else, well, there is. The plug that you use to charge your mobile device can provide more than just power to it. It can also become a high-speed data link, which means that anything can be transmitted over the line. This includes your personal data, can easily be removed from your device, and malware can be installed on your device. This data can be exchanged in an instant without you even knowing or giving any permission. Let's see how it works.
IT experts say your phone can get hacked just by plugging your power cord into any public USB port.
Cell phones, we all use them, from making calls to surfing the web. And when that battery life runs low while you're out or traveling, most head to the nearest public charging station with USB ports.
It's convenient too, so a lot of people use it, I would imagine, especially myself.
But doing that can put you at risk. IT security experts we spoke with say hackers are using a new method called juice jacking. And it's not just at airports, but at hotels, cafes, even theme parks.
When you open up some of these technologies for public use, you also open them up to public misuse.
J. Colin Peterson, CEO of JIT Outsource in Fresno, says the method is similar to the ATM and gas station skimmer devices. He says now hackers are manipulating public USB ports where they can steal your data, text messages, emails, photos, and more.
You get fooled into plugging in. Therefore, you open yourself up to the vulnerability that exists on that surreptitious device that the evildoer would place into effect.
So how can you prevent this happening to you? Do just what Victor Diaz is doing, using the cube with your cord and plugging it right into the wall.
I haven't had my cube on me, my charger, so I just didn't really think much of it. I just kind of sat down, plugged it in. But now I'm glad to know that it's actually another way to secure my information.
IT security experts say it's a good idea to bring an extra battery pack or purchase a USB port defender. You can find those online. It doesn't have the data pins and only used for charging power.
So in addition to this, employ some sort of remote wiping software. Most devices have this. They have it built in so that you can enable, this basically enables you to erase all of the data on the phone from any remote location. And this can save you a lot of aggravation if your device actually becomes lost or is stolen. When you activate a wiping any sort of a wiping service, all of the data and the apps and the call records and the texts on the phone will be completely erased. And the second that the phone connects to any cell tower or internet connection, this happens and everything goes away. Ideally, this will happen before a thief who stole your phone cracks your password. This is why you need to make sure that your password is a good one. And finally, back up your phone often. This is a very important security step, especially if you use a remote wiping service. Backups will allow you to easily recover your data if it's lost or if your mobile phone is stricken with some sort of ransomware, which is all the rage now in the cyber world. And fortunately, most devices will constantly back up your data to a local computer or a cloud if cloud services are enabled and you pay for the sufficient amount of storage space. And these are both really convenient and effective options that don't cost much. Check with the manufacturer to look up how to do this for each of your devices if you're interested in backing up. Oh, and one more thing. Remember, your mobile device is constantly listening for you to give it a command. Things like, hey Siri, okay Google. And many of us wonder if companies or the government are actually using your mobile devices to spy on you. Let's take a look.
You are having a coffee with a close friend and bring up how you need a new bathing suit. Then, bam, all of a sudden there are ads on your phone for bathing suits. Our smartphones are with us at all times, but are companies and governments using them to spy on us? You may be suspicious for a good reason. A New York Times piece uncovered that thousands of apps, including gaming apps for kids, are equipped with the software Alfonso. Alfonso uses your smartphone microphone to listen to the ads that you are watching on TV. It uses audio signals to collect TV viewing data in order for advertisers to personally promote things to you online. Alfonso claims to not record human speech. Facebook has created a device called Pixel, which is designed as a way to continue tracking you online even after you've left a website. By dropping a small piece of data called a cookie, your device will now remember information, like how long you linger on a certain item and whether you added anything to your shopping cart but didn't purchase it. Millions of websites use Facebook Pixel, which is why the hat you didn't end up buying follows you around Facebook forever. But sites like Facebook even follow you offline and have been known to purchase information and create a database of over 52,000 different attributes about you. For example, Facebook buys data from supermarket loyalty programs. So if you have a points card with a grocery store, Facebook may be paying to understand your purchasing patterns, potentially learning about what you eat or even what type of toothpaste you use. So your phone can listen to you, but it can also follow you as well. Every time you receive a text or use data to load an app, companies can log and retain your location based on the cell tower and cellular antenna you connect it to. The precision of location has increased over time and can paint a detailed picture of where you go. So your phone may start sending you ads for swimsuits because you were just physically in or near a surf shop. These companies will claim they aren't doing anything you haven't agreed to, as you have accepted the privacy policy that allows the collection of your information. And did you read the fine print? Probably not. A study presented 543 participants with a fake app called NameDrop to see how many would read the privacy policy and terms of service. 74% skipped reading the agreement altogether, and those who did read it didn't do a great job. 98% of participants missed the gotcha clauses, which included sharing all your data with the NSA, your employer, and agreeing to provide your firstborn child as payment. And what about the rise of smart speakers like Google Home and Amazon Alexa, which are designed to listen to you at all times? Though they are supposed to only record your voice when given prompts like, "Okay, Google." Recently, a couple found that Amazon's Alexa recorded a private conversation and then randomly sent it to a friend. These are deemed unfortunate glitches, but what if someone gained access to them, as Wi-Fi networks and mobile internet devices are easier to hack than you might think? Your typical wireless internet information is kept confidential by being converted from a readable state to nonsense at the access point, and then converted back to a readable state when you use the correct Wi-Fi password from your computer. When internet moved from physically wired networks to wireless technology, it became easier to hack and less secure because the encryption schemes are relatively simple. For example, your webcam can be hacked by creating a remote access tool, which is the digital equivalent of someone adding an unlocked window to your home without you even noticing. Also, the FBI agent meme isn't far from the truth, as the FBI is known to use phishing, which is slipping a link into a message that is labeled in a misleading way. When you hit the link, your device connects to the FBI's computer, downloading malware, which is then able to covertly spy on you. Long story short, your phone is capable of listening to you, following you, and even watching you.
And remember, your devices are always under attack. You can help keep your devices safe by enabling fingerprint recognition, if it's allowed, by using strong passwords, and I can't emphasize that enough, by turning off your Wi-Fi and Bluetooth broadcasting when you don't need to use them, and turning off location access services for the applications that don't even require them and when you're not using them. Make sure that you use a charging cord and a charging block that came with your device or one that came directly from the manufacturer. And back up your mobile device just in case it gets infected with ransomware or somebody steals it or, in my case, you lose it. And turn off your device when it's not in use. Now, I also suggest purchasing a little camera cover to cover the camera lens when you don't need to be using the camera lens. Now, if you don't want to spend the money on an official lens cover, but they're pretty cheap, you can always just use a simple piece of painter's tape, and I've done that before. So, as always, be senior smart, but also be cyber smart, and see you in cyberspace.